very warm welcome to Siloam, to each and every one of you. It's good to see you. It's not quite so nice outside as it's been in the past few weeks. There's been one or two downpours, but it's nice and dry in here anyway, and it's always good to have fellowship with you. For those of you we haven't seen for a while, a very, very special welcome to you. Well, now then, our Bible study, which is still on Zoom, that's changed. It's now at 6 o'clock, so it'll be 6 o'clock this evening. It'll be led by John as we continue studying James. So that's 6 o'clock, not 7 o'clock as it has been. Kids Club will be on Tuesday, and everything else I'm sure you can see in your links or the Facebook page or indeed the website. So shall we just bow our heads and ask God for his blessing? Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have Siloam, a place where we can gather safely together to worship you. And we thank you for fellowship with one another over the past 15 or 16 months. We've realized how precious a thing fellowship is. And we thank you that you are in the midst of us, because that is what you have promised. Help us through your Spirit to worship you in a way that is pleasing to you. And we ask that you would bless each and every one of us. For we ask in the precious name of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, now then, this is the hymn I chose last week, but I somehow managed to send Morrison the wrong hymn. This is Charles Wesley's hymn, Jesus, the Name High Over All. So shall we stand to listen? And you can sing quietly if you can manage that, and if you wish to do so, behind your masks. we're going to look this week, and indeed next Sunday, on Psalm 84. So let's turn to Psalm 84 together. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar. O Lord Almighty, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains also cover it with pools. They go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion. Hear my prayer, O Lord God Almighty. Listen to me, O God of Jacob. Look upon our shield, O God. Look with favour on your anointed one. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favour and honour. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. O Lord Almighty, blessed is the man who trusts in you. And we give thanks to God for his holy and precious word. And I'm sure you agree it's a beautiful psalm, isn't it? Psalm 84. And possibly we can identify with the sentiments of the words of this psalm more than ever, having experienced what we've experienced in the last 15 or 16 months, being unable on many occasions to worship together, to gather together to worship like this. And the psalm is attributed to the sons of Korah. Now, Korah was a Levite, a tribe especially chosen by God to deal with the religious life and the administrative life of the temple. This tribe was totally dedicated to looking after the affairs of the temple. And the original Korah was executed after leading a rebellion against Moses. However, his descendants were blessed when David appointed them, the sons of Korah, the children of Korah, to be musical leaders at the temple. Now, what I'd like to do this morning, very briefly, is to look at how the psalmist uses the word blessed, because on three occasions he uses the word blessed, and on this occasion, in this psalm, blessed simply means happy. Happy. It can mean, like in the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5, it can mean congratulations. And of course, we are often told to bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, the Bible says, the Psalm says. And there it means that we give God the highest level of our praise. But here it simply means happy. And in verses 4, 5 and 12, we see the psalmist using the word blessed, or indeed happy. Gwyn fyd in Welsh. Blessed are those, first of all, who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Or happy are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Now it's clear that the psalmist, whoever he was deeply troubled, because he, for whatever reason, was unable to attend the temple. Maybe it was the time of one of the great feasts, and he would normally be so looking forward to visiting Jerusalem, to visit temple, to have sacrifices offered for his sins. But for whatever reason, he was now unable to attend. We know that Israel and Judah were, and indeed continue to be, very turbulent places. There were many warfares during Old Testament times, especially when it was often impossible for people to travel to Jerusalem, to go to the temple to celebrate the great feasts that God himself had established. And this clearly was a subject of heartbreak, great heartbreak for this psalmist. He was even jealous of the sparrow. At least the sparrow can make its nest at the temple. The sparrow is there all the time. We don't have sparrows, but we do have bees in Siloam. There's a bee's nest outside. Now, can you imagine being jealous of the bees? The bees are able to be here all the time, but we are unable to visit at all, as if the psalmist was saying. He was even jealous of the sparrow. And as I said a little earlier, maybe over the past year and a quarter or so, we've been able to identify with that. We tend to take fellowship for granted, don't we? We tend to take family for granted, despite family and fellowship being a tremendous blessing. We often forget how much of a blessing these things are until we're unable to enjoy fellowship and time with our family. And this is what's happened in the last year and a quarter. So often we've been unable to gather together. It's not been safe, and indeed sometimes not even been legal for us to do so. And when that's been taken away, we realize how precious a thing it is. Even if we didn't wake up every Sunday morning almost jumping in to our clothes, oh, we can't wait to get to Siloam, when it's taken away from us, we realize how precious a thing it is that we can gather together. Happy are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. But maybe the psalmist was guilty of thinking that the living God could only be experienced within the temple buildings. And this is something that God wanted to avoid in his people. And indeed, one of the things that the Jews of the exile learned is that God isn't confined to any building any one city or any one country, that God is omnipresent. Indeed, didn't Solomon say one who actually built the temple, but will God really dwell on earth? The heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you. How much less this temple I have built. Even Solomon, who built this magnificent temple, this temple designed by God, recognized that even this temple couldn't confine, couldn't restrict, put limits on God's presence. The temple was only a symbol of God's presence. But he felt that his worship could only be truly expressed there. Now, yes, it was designed by God. It was there that the sacrifices would be offered. And before it was lost, the Ark of the Covenant was there. The priesthood was practicing its work there. It was a place of great blessing. It was. But God couldn't just be found there only. God is everywhere. There's a wonderful hymn, which I think I've quoted before. My Duw, yn llond pob lle, God, God's presence fills everywhere. My Duw, yn llond pob lle, presennol, ym mhob man, he is present everywhere. Y nesaf yw e fe, at bawb o enaid gwan. He is so close to every weak soul. Wrth law o hyd i wrando cri, always at hand or on hand to hear my plea, my cry, nesai at ddew sydd dda i mi. To draw close to God is good for me. God is omnipresent, but listen, I'm not saying for a moment that there is nothing special about a chapel, that there's nothing special about the bricks and mortar. It is special. The chapel is special. It was built primarily so that it could be the home for God's people, the church. We are blessed to have a chapel. It was built so that God could be at the center. People's lives have always been busy. It's not just our generation that's been busy and distracted. Every generation has had its busy lives, and a chapel gives an opportunity to take a step out of the world and to put God at the centre. It's wonderful to have a home for the church, and it offers us an opportunity to serve one another and to serve the community around us. And I would say that churches, the people of God, that have not got a home, well, they are more limited in the way that they can serve one another and serve the community around them. So a chapel is important, is special, is precious, and a place of God's blessing. How many people have come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Saviour within these walls and in chapel buildings? I dare say, dear friends, a great many. over the decades and centuries. But we must always be careful not to make the chapel itself the object of our worship. That we mustn't let the chapel become more important than Christ himself. And that is something that has certainly happened. Yes, the chapel is a blessing. We have seen so many Christians heartbroken in countries where there is great persecution of the Christian church, where their chapels are burnt and vandalized, because that is the home of their church. I hope that nobody in this chapel this morning has ever experienced a fire at home, or even had their houses burnt due to an appliance or something going on fire. Now, if that house has been burnt, at least you have your family, but you're still heartbroken that your home where your family lives is no longer there. I think it was John Wesley, as a little boy, was sleeping, wasn't he, upstairs, and the house went on fire. And of course, in those days, with so much dry wood and thatched roofs, the house went up very, very quickly. And I think it was his father, Samuel Wesley, plucked John Wesley out from the window, and the house just burnt to the ground. And somebody said to Samuel Wesley, John Wesley's father, "You have lost everything, you poor man." "No," he said, "I have my family. I am rich enough." But it was still heartbreaking to lose the house. The family is the most important thing, but the house is important, absolutely. But God doesn't just dwell in this house. I hope that over the last 15 months, dear friends, we've been reminded that Dyw is cond pob lle, that God is present everywhere, that we have been able to worship him even when we have been alone, that he has been in our homes, that he has not been restricted to one place. And even, God forbid, if this building was to become condemned or burnt down or whatever, we would realize that the church, the family, would continue. Because ultimately, you and I, the people, are God's temple. He dwells within his people and with his people. What do we read in Ephesians chapter 2? In Jesus, the whole building, that is you and me, the people, not bricks and mortar, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Isn't that wonderful? As I said last week, we are the body of Christ. We are the temple of the living God, and he has made his dwelling among us. And again, I would quote the hymn by William Cowper, though some call him William Cowper. "Jesus, where'er thy people meet, there they behold thy mercy seat. where'er they seek thee, thou art found. And every place is hallowed ground. For thou, within no walls confined, inhabitest the humble mind. I love this. Such ever bring thee where they come and go in, take thee to their home. It's not just a case of meeting God here and leaving him here. He comes with us. He's always with us. Where have you been in the last 15 months? You've been at home, possibly in hospital. Maybe you've had a loved one in hospital and been unable to visit that loved one, and it's been horrible. It's been dreadful. But I can promise you this. In those horrible, lonely, helpless experiences, and not just since the beginning of COVID, but before then, God has been with you, and God remains with you. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. It's not always easy to praise, is it, when things are going wrong, when things are going against us, when things make us unhappy, when it seems that the enemy is having the upper hand. But if God is for us, who can be against us? He is the God of the cross, where our sins were atoned for once for all. He is the God of the empty grave. He is our Saviour, our ever-present, very present help in trouble. Let's continue to praise him in spirit and truth. Let's continue to praise him. Let's look at the blessings. Let's look at the fact that, yes, we slept, we awoke again, for God has sustained us. And let us give thanks and praise to God. Blessed or happy are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. But secondly, dear friends, blessed are those, we read in verse 5, blessed are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. Happy then are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. That's what we are, isn't it? Pilgrims. Another Welsh hymn by Williams Pantycelyn, Pererin, that's what pilgrim is, isn't it? Pererin, Pererin oedd mewn anial dir. We are pilgrims in a scorched, lifeless land. And pilgrims, a pilgrimage, is not just a journey, it's a spiritual journey, isn't it? That's what a pilgrimage is, pererin dod. It has, I don't know, a spiritual destination. This psalmist, if I can use a modern phrase, was gutted, wasn't he? He was gutted because he couldn't be a pilgrim. He couldn't be amongst the pilgrims going to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover or Tabernacles or Pentecost or even one of the lesser feasts. He was unable to, prohibited for whatever reason, and he was gutted. And he realized, well, happy are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. One of the things that's happened over the past 15, 16 months his people have had to cancel their plans, haven't they? How many weddings have been postponed in that time? How many holidays have had to be cancelled, especially holidays abroad? And people have set their hearts, haven't they, on that wedding day. The bridezillas had bought their dresses and booked the flowers and so on and so forth. And then, of course, maybe much to the groom's delight, it's all been cancelled, postponed for another year. And oh, we were so looking forward to going to Tenerife, to Portugal, or wherever, and then be told that you can't go, or to visit family abroad, maybe. And your hearts were set on this, and it's been taken away. Of course it's disappointing. Of course it's heartbreaking. And this man, this psalmist, has set his heart on going to one of those feasts. And he couldn't, well, happy are those who have set their hearts and they are able to go. Able to go on this spiritual journey. There was a blessing waiting for them. They were able to meet with many, many of God's people. As I've already said, sacrifices offered for their sins, singing psalms and songs of praise to God with multitudes in Jerusalem. It was such a blessing. And now it had been taken away. Such a blessing it would be. But for those who were able to go, well, such a blessing awaited them. But to get there, it meant that they had to walk through the valley of Baca. And Baca means weeping. The New English Bible calls it the Thirsty Valley. Doesn't use the word Baca, calls it the Thirsty Valley. And it wasn't very nice going through the Thirsty Valley, the Valley of Baca. In the Bible, we often see that the mountain top is the place of great blessing, don't we? There's another hymn in Welsh that's quite wonderful. Ar y mynydd gyda dim o mor ogoneddus yw, on the mountain with God, how glorious that is. But the valley in the Bible is often as seen as a place of darkness and dread, a place of weeping. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, the psalm says. And to get to this place of blessing, the pilgrimage, this spiritual journey, this journey with God, meant that sometimes you had to walk through the weeping valley. Following Jesus, dear friends, won't stop us passing through difficult, sad, and dry circumstances. But when we walk through those valleys, the valleys of Baca, the weeping valleys, the psalmist gives us a challenge. We are to make them a place of springs. We have been called to be a blessing to others. Do you understand? To to bring hope in those seemingly hopeless situations. Not just to let it happen to us and us being inactive, but God wants us to be a blessing, a comfort to others, so that those weeping valleys, those dry, arid valleys, can be a place of springs. That's what we are called to be, dear friends, a place of springs. We are to bring the hope of the gospel into such circumstances. But how? How? Well, again, listen to the verse. Blessed or happy are those whose strength is in you. Whose strength is in God. We don't rely on our own strength. We rely on the strength that God gives us through His Spirit, the enabling power of His Spirit. It is there in abundance, dear friends. Ask for it, and He shall freely, freely give. I know Paul said in Philippians chapter 4, and I was reminded just a few days ago of this beautiful verse. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through Him who gives me strength. It wasn't Paul who was able to find contentment in the good and bad circumstances. It was God who gave him strength. Happy are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. And finally, dear friends, in verse 12, blessed is the man who trusts in you. Happy is the man who trusts in you. Trust is a huge thing, isn't it, dear friends? It means, or it entails, commitment. Doesn't it? You show, you prove, you give evidence of the trust that you have in the commitment that you give. There's no point saying, well, you trust in somebody and then show no commitment. Trust equals commitment. And if we trust God, we have to be committed to that trust. If there is anybody anywhere under the conviction of sin and needing the assurance of salvation, well, we would say, trust in God, trust in the God of the cross, trust in the Christ who died on the cross to make atonement for your sin. But trust wholeheartedly in that. Give it your full commitment. Don't trust in anything or anyone else but the cross, the blood that was shed there. It requires 100% commitment in that, doesn't it? Not a partial commitment, but 100% belief that Christ atoned for our sins on the cross. And in our spiritual journey, our spiritual experiences, we must trust in God. That's what brings true happiness, true peace of mind, that contentment in whatever the circumstances, is that trust in God. We are so much the poorer if we are only happy when the experiences and circumstances are good and pleasurable, without pain. How much more blessed we are if we find happiness and peace when our experiences are painful. Trust, dear friends, in God. What does the hymn say? Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. So shall we stand and listen to our next hymn, Stuart Townsend, or Townhymns, I should say, interpretation of the Lord's My Shepherd. So shall we stand, if you so wish?
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead. Guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure. I will trust in you, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me. Trust in you, for
You are the most holy God, and we are a sinful people that fall short of your glory, but Lord, you have made it possible for us to approach your throne. Lord, we thank you for Jesus, the cross, the empty grave, the fact that he has ascended to his throne where he lives to intercede for us. We thank you for giving us the promised Holy Spirit. We thank you that you have given us the right, even though we do so with respect and with humility, you've given us the right to approach your throne with confidence. And we do so, Lord, in the precious name of Jesus. And we bring our praise and thanksgiving to you, whatever our circumstances, because in those circumstances, you are with us every step of the way. And Lord, we thank you for that, for all the blessings you bestow upon us, material and spiritual blessings. Thank you for them all. But Lord, we would also bring to you those people that are unwell at this time. You are with them in their pain, in their discomfort. And we ask that you would allow them to experience your special touch upon their lives. And maybe some of us know of people that have received devastating news in recent days, knowing that there is a really tough journey ahead for them, involving all kinds of treatments and all sorts of discomfort. We just bring those people to you now, Lord, asking again that you would give them strength and the reassurance of your love every step of the way. Wrth ddaw, o hyd i wrando hi, always there to listen to our plea. Nesai at ddiw sydd dda i mi, to draw near to God, it is good for us. Please forgive us our sins and bless us, for we offer our prayers in the precious name of Jesus, who taught us when praying, to offer this prayer together. So very quietly, let us offer the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, our final hymn, dear friends, "'Tis Finished, the Messiah Dies." Thank you, Melissa. Spirit, remain with us now and forevermore. Amen.